Hello everyone, I'm Rashmi Mangla, working as an assistant professor for the BBA department of St. Andrews Institute of Technology and Management. The subject that I'll be teaching today is organizational behavior. Now, we'll be covering Unit 1 today, and this is our first lecture for Unit 1. The topics that will be covered today are meaning of organizational behavior, nature of organizational behavior, its scope, and elements. All right, now when we talk about organizational behavior, you know, what comes to our mind, it is basically a study, you know, which gives insight on how employees behave and perform in the workplace, you know, the behavior of employees in the workplace. That is what organizational behavior deals about. And so let's see the definition of organizational behavior. Now Lutyens has given us a definition which says that organizational behavior, that is OB, is directly concerned with the understanding, prediction, and control of human behavior in organizations. Now, you know, basically it deals with understanding. We try to understand, we try to predict, and we try to control the behavior of humans, which is there in the organization. Now, also, apart from this, you know, it is a study of the way people interact within groups, or they interact amongst themselves in the organization. It is also the study of both group and individual performance and activity within an organization. It is a systematic study and application of knowledge about how individuals and groups act within the organization where they work. So basically, it deals with the way they behave, the way they perform their activities, the way they present themselves in the organization. That all comes under organizational behavior. And as we already know, you know, out of all the resources which are there in the organization, human resource is the precious one, and the behavior of human being is also unpredictable. That is, it is quite unique in nature. So that is why, you know, that it's very important to understand and interact and, you know about the nature of human beings. Why? So that ultimately it is the human resource who's going to work for the organization and who are going to make our organization prosper. So that is why, you know, knowing about organization behavior is very important. Now, next we move on to nature of organization behavior. It is a separate field of study and not a discipline only. It is an interdisciplinary approach, an applied science, a humanistic and optimistic approach, as well as a total system approach. Now, if we talk about, you know, the first one, it is a separate field of study and not a discipline only. Now, as we know, a discipline is what? It is an accepted science, you know, which is based on some kind of, let's say, theoretical foundation. That is discipline. But organizational behavior is kind of, you know, multi-interdisciplinary oriented, because it deals with a lot of concepts. It deals with all the behavior, all the way the people behave in the organization. So it is a field of study and not basically a discipline. Now, next we talk about interdisciplinary approach. Now, when we talk about this, you know, it is essentially this kind of approach, because, you know, the way human beings behave at work, it tries to integrate the relevant knowledge drawn from related disciplines like psychology, sociology, anthropology. You know, it tries to just integrate all those kind of knowledge. So it is interdisciplinary. It is kind of interrelated to all the concepts. And why does, you know, it kind of integrates? It integrates so that to make all the knowledge applicable for studying and analyzing organization behavior, so that we can study all the aspects, be it social, be it psychological aspect of the human being. We have to study all of that, and on the basis of that, we analyze their behavior. Then it is an applied science. Now it is applied. Why? Because, you know, application means we kind of try to put it on in every areas. So organizational behavior, what it basically does is, it is the application of various researches to solve the organizational problems. We do some research work, and those researches which we have done, we use them. Why do we use them? In order to solve the problems which arise in the organization. Which kind of problems? The problems which are related to human behavior. We mainly deal with them here. All right. So that is why we say that it is an applied science, because whatever researches we do in this field, we apply all of them in the organization to deal with the problems. Now, next one, a humanistic and optimistic approach. Organizational behavior, you know, it implies towards humanistic approach. Now, when we talk about humanistic approach, it says that it basically works towards people working in the organization. It deals with the thinking and feelings of the human being. We give it a humanistic approach. We think from humanistic point of view. Hum logo ke point of view se sochte hain in this one. You know, we consider organization considers their human, you know, their laborers also as a human. Instead of considering it as a factor of production, they consider them as human beings. They think about their feelings, their emotions, and all those things are covered in this. Then, apart from that, it also realizes that people working in the organization can and will actualize these potentials if they are given proper conditions and environment. So basically, it also has an optimistic approach. Optimistic means being positive. So according to this approach, you know, in the organization, it is also realized that people who are working, jo log wahan kaam kar rahe, you know, they will actualize. Agar unko abhi nahi bhi pata hai what is their potential, they'll try to find out. They'll try to work on their skills. And when will they work on it? When they are motivated, when they have proper working conditions and environment. So environment also affects performance or performance of the workers who are working in an organization. All right. So it is a humanistic and optimistic approach. They keep their thinking positive, and they also think from human point of view. Their feeling, their emotions, everything is covered. Then last one is, it is a total system approach. Now, total system, as we can see, you know, which comprises of all the things. So basically, this system approach is one that integrates all the variables which affect the organizational functioning. That means all those points which can affect the functioning of the organization, all those are covered in total system approach. So the systems approach, you know, it has been developed by to analyze human behavior in view of his or her socio-psychological framework. Their social needs are also thought of, and their psychological needs are also thought of here. So that's why we say it is a total system approach. It comprises of all the factors. So all these are nature of organization behavior. Children, these are the key points which you can note down. Then next we move on to scope of organization behavior. Now, when we talk about scope of organization behavior, you know, there are mainly three concepts which are integrated. First one is individuals, which we also call as individual behavior. Now, it is a study of personality or attitude, inspiration, job satisfaction of a person, or, you know, we can also say their learnings, their values, all that comes under individuals. For example, like, in addition to the ones mentioned in resume, you know, you've made a CV. There are some key points. There are, you know, some your positive points which you mention in the resume. But apart from those, there might be some, you know, that which the when you are going for an interview, all those points which are mentioned in the resume that the interviewer can read. But apart from those points, there are some more points, you know, which the interviewer can judge from the way you present yourself. So all those points come under the individualistic approach, the scope. All right. Then, for example, you know, one more thing. When you have written that you can communicate in English in your CV, I'll just give you more example to make it more clear. But when you actually communicate with the interviewer, he will get to know that what sort of communication skills you possess. Like, are you very fluent or it's average? So that only that he gets to know only when he personally communicates to you. All right. Then next we come to groups, that is inter-individual behavior or behavior at group level. This is the second scope of organization behavior. Now, it is a study of people, where we get to know about people's leadership qualities. We get to know about group conflicts, which deals with communication, which deals with power and politics, all right? And all those things are between the employees and their subordinates. For example, group conflicts. In an organization, there are certain groups that are formed, you know. Obviously, if you're working somewhere, you will not be talking you will not easily get mingled with each and every person. There are only a few of them with whom you feel comfortable. There are only a few of them with whom you mingle easily, you know. So those are the persons with whom you communicate. Then there might be a team with whom you would be working, and maybe you are the team leader, so that means you inculcate leadership qualities, or maybe you are the one who's able to take correct decisions for your whole team, so that means you are able to possess those leadership qualities. Then again, if you are a leader, you are in a state of power, and at times there are some leaders who play some politics within the organization, you know, that we'll be learning organization politics in the upcoming units. Apart from that, there might be group conflicts, you know, when you have groups. Obviously, if a set of people are there, there might be some reasons where everybody will not agree, and that is where the conflicts arise. So all this comes under the second scope of organizational behavior, that is the groups. Third one is the structure. All right, now structure is the basically behavior at organizational level. Now group behavior studies the structure of an organization, formation of organization, and effectiveness of the organization. So here we deal with culture, change, development, and structure. So this, in the structure, we cover the entire organization. For example, in the case of individual, we were considering only the individual level. In the case of group, we were considering a bit high level where we have a certain group of people. But in the case of structure, we talk about the whole organization at a vast level. Clear? So a set of culture which is followed in the organization, or any changes that are brought in the organization, that is for everybody, for all the people of the organization. If there are some development programs being run, that will be on an overall level, maybe for one department, maybe for other department, but that will be the same, all right, for the entire group of people who are working in a particular department. So these are the scope of organizational behavior. Now next we move on to key elements of organizational behavior. Now there are three internal organizational elements. The internal ones are people, technology, and structure. You can jot down this, children. There are mainly two, you know, they are divided into two, internal and external. Internal ones are people, technology, and structure. And the fourth element, which is external, is social system or environment. All right, now we'll talk about the first one. That is the people. Now who are people? The people constitute the internal social system. Internal means they are the ones who are working. So they consist of the individual or the groups. And again, groups may be large or small, formal or informal, official or unofficial. All right, unofficial. So they all comprise of people. So all those, you know, the set of employees who are working, they all come under this element, people. They form, change, and disband. Human organization, you know, it changes every day. So it is not the same as it was yesterday. Maybe there was a certain level of people who were working 1 year ago and some of them have left. So it keeps on changing. And in the upcoming days also, it is likely to change. Then people are living, thinking, feeling, and being who created the organization, try to achieve the objectives and goals. So mainly, organization exists to serve the people, and not the people exist to serve the organization. The organization is existing so that it can serve the community or the people, all right? And the people are not serving the organization, whereas the opposite thing happens. Clear? Then second key element of organizational behavior is structure. Again, structure defines the sole relationship of people in an organization. What relationship people have in the organization, that comes under structure. Now different people in an organization are given different roles, and they have certain relationship with others. For example, this, you know, some may be just regular employees, some of them may be team leaders, someone may be an assistant manager, someone may be a deputy manager. So everybody has a different role to play, they have a different designation, and again on the basis of their designation, they have a relationship with others to be maintained. And this kind of different roles leads to division of labor, so that people can perform their duties or work to accomplish the organizational goal. So that is why everybody cannot be accountant or a clerk. You know, just an example. Like, can everybody work as a clerk? No. Can everybody work as an accountant? No. So there might be some people who are working as a clerk, some people who are, you know, working at a higher level than them, maybe they are their superiors, some people who might be working as a manager. And every superior, you know, every subordinate has to report to its superior person. All right, this is how the work carries on. The higher authority will tell the work to the manager, maybe. Manager will pass on the task which has to be done to the assistant manager. An assistant manager will give it to the team leader. For example, we are just following a chain. It will give it to the team leader for that team, jisko kaam karna hai again. And the team leader will be assigning the task to the members of the team. So that is how the structure works out, and that is how tasks can be completed. Organization can fulfill its goals only when division of labor is possible. Clear? Then next is technology. Technology, again, it imparts the physical and economic conditions within which people work. What physical conditions and economic conditions, like what kind of, you know, what kind of buildings are there, what kind of machines have been provided, what kind of tools are there, all that comes under these kind of conditions, these kind of needs. So the nature of technology depends very much upon the nature of the organization and influences the work or working condition. Obviously, technology will influence the work and working condition. Let's say there is an organization, you know, where export products are made. If the embroidery is being done by the human resource, that is the human labor, it will take more time, whereas if they have got machines for embroidery, so it will take less time. That means the work gets influenced by the level of technology. Agar machines ke through kaam kare to kaam jaldi ho jayega, hum zyada products bana payenge. Whereas agar we are doing it with the help of manual labor will obviously take more time, the products kam produce honge. All right, so technology has a huge impact upon the organization's work. Now technology also brings effectiveness and at the same time restricts people in various ways. It brings effectiveness because it can lead to large numbers of production. Production might increase because of technology. And at the same level, it can restrict people also in some or the other ways. For example, it can, you know, when the work was done by manual labor, the things were more precise, the designs were more unique. But when it is being done just by the machine, it will not be unique. It will be just monotonous. Same type ka hi design banega. Whereas, jo manual labor bana raha tha, everybody has a different skill and the design will come out unique. So, there are some pros and cons of technology as well. Then, last one is social system. Now, social system, we consider it as external environment. You know, it provides external environment which the organization operates, where the organization operates. A single organization cannot exist also. So can only one organization exist? No, it is a part of the whole. One organization cannot give everything. And therefore, we have many other organizations who are working. And all these organizations influence each other. They influence the attitudes of the people, their working conditions, and above all, provide competition for resources and power. So when there are more than one organization, obviously there will be competition in the market. There will be competition in the attitudes of the people. Maybe one organization is giving quite a good level of amenities, quite a good level of perks to its employees, and second organization is not giving it. So that can, you know, we have a level of comparison that we can do if there are a large number of organizations. So that comes under social system, and it is an external environment because it comes, it leads to, you know, it is not within the scope of the organization. Organization ke bahar ka jo bhi concept hai, that comes under social system, external environment. Clear? These are the key elements of organization behavior. Children, I hope you have jot down the main key points which I have told. Apart from there, you can just jot down the points from here as well. Now, there are a few questions that we'll be seeing and which you'll have to solve yourself. These are the questions. You can jot down the questions. Define organizational behavior. Explain the key elements of organizational behavior. Describe the nature and scope of organizational behavior. So this was our lecture 1 for organizational behavior. Stay tuned for more videos of lecture 1 for unit 1. Thank you, everyone.